You did say something that I think resonates with so many people is that you kind of fell into it.
Oh, yes.
And I feel like so many of us started somewhere else,
yep.
or, you know, just kind of saw it, or maybe it was a friend recommended, or yep. it was an internship, and immediately, it's like it has such a grasp on us of the passion that follows, is immediately we fall in love with it.
100%.
And it's a complete fall. It's mm-hmm. it's not something where you're like, oh, I'm going to dabble in it. Nope.
Yep.
You're in it.
You're in it.
Your first day, you're here for life.
Yeah, seriously. I asked, like, everyone, you know, if someone asks me, like, you know, how did you get into ABA? It's always, well, how did you fall into ABA?
Yeah.
Because I think the overall consensus is we didn't start here. Very few of us have, right?
Yeah.
But, I mean, talk to me. Like, when you guys were younger, you probably wanted to be a teacher, a veterinarian, a lawyer, right?
Hockey player.
Something that,
ask
you know,
if
we
I can
came,
skate.
I don't.
Can't. Can't answer is no.
But that doesn't matter because you're here now.
Right. That's an old dream. I have new ones now.
But exactly. Like, we kind of fell into this, and I'm really happy with this science and our field, and
yeah.
I'm sure we'll get into it later, but something I say all the time is, all right, cool, I fell into this. Now how am I going to get out?
Because mm-hmm.
I want to get out while I still love it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
That's a very interesting concept, already looking that far into the future
100%.
Of like, I may become burnt. How do I navigate that before it actually happens?
100%.
So then with that being said, I'm sure you have many other passions outside
yeah.
of ABA if you're able to think that
do
far
tell.
Ahead. So what do those look like?
Like more like hobbies or like passions within our science that is not like ASD?
Both, because I'm assuming that you use ABA across all of those things.
I do. So, well, I mean, one of my biggest hobbies right now is I collect crystals. I chart the moon. You know, I'm really into numerology, so those angel numbers. So those of you, I mean, you know, my Instagram right now, the Mystical Analyst, is really tailored to my hobby of spirituality mixed with ABA, right? I feel like that is something that we don't really talk about a lot or enough, but I can't tell you how many people at my job have the same 222 tattoo.
Mm-hmm.
This is very out of my realm. I have no idea what any of this is. Like,
yeah.
in terms of, like, the angel numbers,
mm-hmm.
is that what you had
yep.
said?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So tell me about that.
Sure. So if you see numbers in a repeated fashion, typically they come in threes or fours, right? That is a sign that your angels who have passed on are looking after you and are with you, and they're telling you something. So each number sequence means something in particular. So 222, for example, means that you're in the right place at the right time. I ended up getting these tattoos, 222 and 444, immediately after I passed the BCBA exam because I took the test on July 2nd. I was number two in line, and my computer was number two.
I like that. Mm-hmm. My lucky number is two, so
right?
I'm all about it.
Right? So I was like, okay, somebody's talking to me. I'm okay, right? I'm in the right place at the right time. So 222 has resonated with me really like since then.
Interesting. And then what's the 444?
That typically is your angels. They are with you. You don't have to worry about anything. Like, you know, your guardian angels are there. They got me covered, right? I started seeing that a lot on the clock when my grandfather passed away. We have a battery-operated wall clock mm-hmm. in our home. And the night that he passed, the time it stopped at was 444. So I said, don't touch it. It doesn't need a new battery. Leave it alone. It's there for decoration now. So that's my connection with, you know, 444.
Now, with that being said, as a behavior analyst,
yeah.
obviously this is a very taboo area. And you
100%.
Had said that too. And like you can connect with a lot of people at work. Most likely a lot of them are not behavior analysts.
Yeah.
So from a behavior analyst lens,
mm-hmm.
how do you tie in ABA with a lot of these things like the crystals, the angel numbers, the numerology, all of that stuff?
Well, that's a great question because I feel like I'm the most scientific evidence-based person that there is, but I believe rocks have meaning. So it's like weird.
Yeah.
Right? I think for me, tying the ABA into is more of the discipline. It's more of the practice, right? So not only am I collecting the crystals, right? I'm taking the time out and to understand then their origin and things like that. I'm using ABA to help me, you know, with those crystals and help those crystals in terms of guiding my life, my practices, my discipline, et cetera.
Does it almost fall into an act category? And you can totally correct me if I'm wrong. Or do they somehow blend together?
I feel like it could fall into like an act category, right? Because you're kind of reframing, right? Like whether or not Amethyst really helped me pass that board exam or not, I don't know. Right. Yeah. I doubt it, right? Scientifically, I studied my ass off, right?
Yeah.
Like I studied, I passed the test. That amethyst had nothing to do with it. But at the same time, it's more of a practice. And it's very similar to exercising and like working out. It's more of that mental stimulation that is kind of, you know, promoting that discipline in your life. So that's where ABA comes into play, that self-monitoring, right? Using that to keep me disciplined in everything that I'm doing, essentially.
Check out the KarmaKollection.com for stylish, ABA-inspired apparel that spreads the message of behavior science with every wear. Free shipping on orders over $120. TheKarmaKollection.com.